thing I found in knocking over 10,000 doors is that people are more likely to open the door if I lead with, I'm a pediatrician, as opposed to, I'm running for office. All right?
Hi there, I'm Councilmember Evan Glass, and I want to welcome you to my community conversations. Today, I'm being joined by David Myles, who is a Rockville City Council member, and he is also a pediatrician. David, good to see you.
Good to see you again, Councilmember. How you been?
I am well, thank you very much. How are you doing?
Things could always be worse, but I'm fortunate to have a roof over my head, food in my belly, and a job.
That is really good perspective these days. I appreciate that. And so before I ask you any questions, let me ask one quick question. Do you prefer being called council member or doctor?
Dave works best.
Dave it is. Dave, thank you for taking the time out of your really busy schedule. You know, the reason I wanted to talk with you is because I think you are the only doctor who is also an elected official here in Montgomery County.
I,
David Myles,
do affirm that I will.
Do affirm that I will.
Support the Constitution of the United States.
Support the Constitution of the United States.
And just to let everybody know a little bit about you, you attended Yale Medical School and you did your residency up in Baltimore at Johns Hopkins. And tell everybody what you're doing now in terms of your medical profession.
Certainly. So I work primarily in the clinic at Walter Reed Bethesda, which is a military hospital campus here in Montgomery County. It's worked out well because after finishing up residency in Baltimore, I spent 3 years serving active duty in the Navy, so it's a similar population. I continue to spend some weekends working at the emergency department at Holy Cross, which is also here in Montgomery County as well. And it's quite obvious that it's been quite busy. Fortunately, like many pediatrics practices, there's been a move to do some telemedicine. So my clinic, some days I actually spend at home, example today, but certainly emergency medicine is something that you have to be present for. So we've made adjustments, both governmental organizations and private organizations as well.
Absolutely. And you talked about being a little busy. I think that's probably an understatement, humble as you are. So what is the current situation with our area medical facilities? How do you think governments and the medical providers are working together to make sure that everyone in our community is safe and healthy?
I can fortunately say that, I mean, we're fortunate to live in Maryland, from our local municipalities to counties, to the state has been doing the best that we can with the resources that we have. Fortunate that, again, the current governor has taken a pretty proactive role in doing what he could to mitigate the crisis in terms of implementing social distancing while waiting for testing to come in. He did secure some testing from out of the country, which will hopefully help assist us at some of our rapid testing locations that have recently been set up throughout the state, even some here in Montgomery County. At the county level, y'all are doing a great job, again, with as best as you can with regard to the funding, getting information out to us, which has been very critical. Dr. Travis Gales, who's also a pediatrician, has been heading up that response, has done a great job in terms of giving us information, letting us know what holes exist, and helping to make sure that everybody's on the same page. At a local level here in Rockville City Council, we fortunately have a disaster preparedness center, emergency response center, which has also been coordinated with county and state and making sure that our most vulnerable, which in our city are our seniors, are being looked after. And so it's been head to toe a great effort. In terms of the hospital side of it, you know, Holy Cross is one of the major medical facilities here in the county. And we've been, again, coordinating with the state county partners and making sure that we're doing the testing on appropriate patients and making sure that we have surge capacity, like building up infrastructure to deal with the surge of patients. Fortunately, things are kind of leveling off to some degree, but we do not want to get complacent. And I understand that they actually moved in a mobile morgue to at least our hospital and one other here. So that's kind of the lay of the land.
Yeah, and we on the county council, we appropriated $10 million for local hospitals and healthcare networks to draw down from as we get ready for the surge, which has yet to arrive, making sure that our doctors, other medical personnel, and ultimately patients and residents here in Montgomery County have the protections that they need, have the facilities that we need to be healthy, and for you all to do your work. And so I know it has been a strong partnership between us, and you also live locally, but we have also appropriated funds for medical personnel who might be traveling far from other counties or driving greater distances to get to work. And instead of driving back and forth every day, they can stay in a local hotel at a very subsidized rate. And so we are doing everything we can to make the process easier, to make the healthcare delivery system easier, and then ultimately also make it as helpful to the medical professionals like you and your colleagues during this time. But you mentioned that you were a naval doctor.
In the Navy, I was deployed on a humanitarian mission. I worked in El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras.
And I know that you've traveled throughout the world dealing with health crises and other parts of the globe. Talk to me and everybody else about some similarities you might have seen dealing with epidemics in other regions and how we're responding here.
Well, yeah, my work with the Navy, I was fortunate enough to be deployed on a humanitarian mission to 11 countries in Central and South America and the Caribbean. In the context of a continuing promise mission 2015. It's where we use that hospital ship that you may have seen, the USNS Comfort, that was most recently in New York. I'm understanding it's headed back to Virginia to bring that 1,000 bed hospital to various countries.
And that was the ship with the iconic photo of the Red Cross image as it was sailing past the Statue of Liberty. Is that the same ship?
That is, okay. That's correct. And the beauty of that that ship is that and the people that it can hold, we were able to set up an entire clinic in a matter of days, see thousands of patients and pick up and head to the next country. So the ability to scale up resources in a short order has been one of the hallmarks of that particular ship. We saw it deployed to New York, and I know that the mission changed as so many things do. Even when I get my daily updates at Walter Reed, things change on a daily basis. Yeah. So they were able to provide some services. And it appears that as things have leveled off in New York, that ship is headed home. I think the beauty of the military, when things are done right, there's a chain of command and orders are executed. There's no really room to negotiate. And as long as you have that chain of command in place and a great mission, that makes sense and is evidence-based, you create things can happen.
Well, I appreciate that perspective and particularly the tough environments in which you've worked and continue to work in making our community safer. I'm just curious, what other elements of life here, being an elected official and also a medical doctor, what do you think that we can be doing maybe a little better job of here to make sure that our residents are informed and safe?
Well, I think as municipal officials, as providers, frontline providers, be it physicians or people who take out our trash or work in grocery stores, is we really need to, as elected officials, make sure that we're taking care of people. There's been a lot of discussion with regard to the most recent package of legislation that came out of Congress at the federal level, to what extent it will trickle down to the municipalities. There have been a number of stories floated about, budget cuts to states, counties, and so forth, and the prospect of furloughs. The one thing we learned in the Navy, it's mission first, sailors always. And I've used that adage in my work as a city council member. It's, the mission of the city first and take care of people always. So even as we discuss later on this evening what to do about our budget, the last thing I'd ever want to consider is slashing hours or salaries for employees. Again, people having a steady source of income, a livable wage as it's called in some circles, has its own benefits in terms of addressing crises. It allows people to be able to take time off of work without fear that they won't be able to make their rent payments. Yeah. Concomitant with that is making sure that we do have good leave policies in place, not just to address this crisis, which has certainly taught us the need of making sure that we have sick leave in place that allows people to take time off, particularly some of our workers in our long-term care facilities, working with seniors who oftentimes make very little wages and don't have those workplace protections in terms of taking leave. The final aspect, and this is something that we don't have control over at the county or city level, is certainly expanding access to healthcare. There are people who come to our emergency departments who are mandated to test, but do not want to get tested because they fear that they're going to, you know, get a bill at the end of the month. And even in the context of some of the changes to medical billing codes that cover telehealth, people are still getting bills in the mail, which when people, you know, our unemployment's going up is just adding insult to injury in the context of this crisis. But in terms of things that we can do as city, local, elected officials, county, I mean, I think we're doing all we can. We can't print money. So I think we're just doing the best that we have.
Well, I think you framed it right about what we can do here at the county level, at the city level, of making sure that our employees feel safe while they're doing the essential work of caring for our entire community, whether it is in the health and human services sector, the recreation center, our trash pickup and delivery, all of these facets of our community, they run on people. And we need to make sure that they are feeling safe and healthy to make sure that our community continues moving as well. And you know, you also mentioned rent.
We are particularly grateful for all the council members, but particularly Councilmember Tom Hucker, Councilmember Evan Glass, Councilmember Will Jawando.
I was proud to have spearheaded the effort on the council to approve $2 million for rental assistance, knowing that while people are worried about their health, they're worried about their household economics, we need to make sure that they stay in their homes, because the last thing we want is during a stay-at-home order, people to not be able to afford to stay in their homes and to have more people who are experiencing homelessness in our community. And so it really is a holistic approach. That's why I love living here in Montgomery County. I love working with municipal leaders like yourself to ensure that all 1.1 million people in Montgomery County are cared for and feel protected, healthy, and safe during this pandemic. And so, Dr. Dave, Council Member Dave, are there any final thoughts that you want to share with anybody who's watching this just about health and safety in our community?
Certainly. There's a lot of anxiety about things that we have no control over. I would encourage you to take control of things that you can. Again, this has been one of the worst flu seasons that we've seen since H1N1 almost 11 years ago. So if you have the availability, you're at a drugstore, get your flu shot. The second thing, stay in shape. People who have overall, you know, concurrent health problems, be they diabetes, high blood pressure, seem to do worse if they contract coronavirus. So take this as an opportunity to really watch your diet and try to work on some weight loss. And then make sure you take care of yourself, particularly our frontline workers, but everybody, parents, spouses, all of us are caregivers in some form or fashion. Be sure to take care of yourself, because if you can't do that, it's like being on an airplane and they tell you to put your mask on first before helping others. Really do take care of yourselves.
I think those are wise tips, and I thank you for sharing your sage advice to me and to everybody who's watching. I want to thank you for your dedication as a member of the Rockville City Council, and also your commitment to our community through your tenure in the military, in the Navy, and then now as a medical doctor, a pediatrician, an emergency pediatrician here in our community, helping keep everybody safe, particularly the youngest in our community. And so I really appreciate, David, you taking the time to speak with us out of your busy schedule. And for everybody who's watching, if you do live in the city of Rockville, feel free to reach out to your council member, David Myles. And if you are elsewhere in Montgomery County, you can reach out to me, councilmember.glass@montgomerycountymd.gov. If you have any needs, need any support or connection to services, do reach out to me or the Rockville council member. And in the meantime, we all know that we are in this together, so we want you to stay healthy and safe. So thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you. Have a great day.